And junkets.
I've got 10-year-old twins.
Wow.
Boys.
So that keeps you busy.
Yeah, no, but I didn't really get into it until there were two.
Yeah.
I could have gone through life not having had kids, my first kids.
Huh. Well, I waited. I was 45.
Did you?
When Cameron was born, so.
How about 56?
Well, my dad was 49, so I guess I'd been a little bit there myself.
Yeah, okay, yeah, good. How long have you married, though?
About 2.5 years now.
The first?
First marriage.
God damn, you fucking...
I did not want to get divorced. And I would have gotten divorced from pretty much every woman I almost married, so...
Yeah.
I think I waited long enough.
There you go.
I could have sworn
couldn't afford a duck this one. Fucking have you live in a tent on the Santa Monica Pier.
I thought I was going to do it when I was like 22 years old. I was like, sure, I'd be married and have kids. And
23. You know. But then there's no... The only contraception was counting to 10 and pull. Yeah. So all my buddies got their girlfriends pregnant.
Hey.
All shotgun marriages. Have you seen the movie?
I have. I found the movie kind of fascinating because it felt like almost like a response to Pelham for you.
Uh-huh.
Like Pelham was so complicated and internal and inside the train.
Pelham was was ostensibly, you know, a very character-driven piece. This is character and action in conjunction. That was, you know, Pelham was, and everybody says, well, are you in love with trains? I say, no. But Pelham was really a hostage situation in the bowels of New York, you know. And then we had a little bit of train at the end where this was, you know, it's a character-driven piece and it's guys who come through and save the day. But, you know, and all my movies are actually driven by research, you know, so I get out there. So before I make a commitment, so actually, do you want me to talk like this?
It's good. Yeah.
So the day before, I got the script, and it's your initial response to the script is invariably the one you go with.
Yeah? Mm-hmm.
And this one, I went, wow. And I'm terrible, I'm going to slow read it. It always takes me two or three sittings, and I go, I want to make this work, but I can't. And my response to the script was what I think now, and I'll step back 14 months, and I think I've done this, and the movie's ended up where I want it to end up, which is what my initial response to the script was.
Well, it feels like there was less script. Like, it was just... The train was it was almost like you had the world's greatest train set.
Right.
And you just got to... really it felt like you were having a romp, like you were having a great time shooting this.
But it was, you know, it's funny because as a director, you're looking for, well, what do I need to make the drama? What inspires me? And it was characters in conflict on a train which is going 50 to 150 miles an hour.
Mm-hmm.
So for me, you know, in terms of you're always looking for, where do I create the paint for my canvas, you know, and that's what I was actually doing. So I was working against two things. It was almost like a theater piece with the two boys sitting in this confined space, which is a huge challenge to me, you know, because I think, how do I do justice and I'm careful that we don't get overtaken by the pure action of the piece.
And they don't really become part of the action until the third act. I mean,
not exactly. So here they are, guys in conflict, and the old guard being thrown out, the new guard coming in, and again, I say, what I did before I commit to every movie, I read the script, and I'll go and spend time in the real world. So I went down to Pennsylvania and spent a week there. And familiarize myself with the world of railroaders, and I found role models for the guys in there, in and outside of what they say is based on inspired by a true event.
Right.
And then I said to two guys who were, they'd been 12 years together, you know, an engineer and a conductor. I said, how's your first day on the job together? They told me, and I took that.
Huh.
First day and reverse engineered into the script.
Interesting.
And so that's what I always do, you know. And it's whether, you know, it's you know, Man on Fire or Unstoppable or Pelham. You know, we found a role model for John's character, John Travolta's character, guy just got out of jail, and that became.
So what was were there two characters in the train before that were different two guys?
Yes. But when. I'll withhold my trade secrets like that. but what I do, I'll mix and match, but I bring that mix and match to the table with Denzel and Chris and Rosario. Mm-hmm. So I found role models for each of those characters in the real world.
Did you find a female character like Rosario? Is that what it was?
Or? I did, and she worked here at Long Beach. She was she ran the railroad yard here in Long Beach. She was Hispanic, and she rose to that position quickly because her first boss retired, the second one died, and she moved up the food chain. And she was Rosario's, and she was Rosario was a role model. She was Rosario's on the phone, and she came to the set, and it's great for you know, and it's so it's a common denominator, you know, because it's so abstract talking to actors about. You know about how they should deliver their lines or cut their hair, or but when you sign off on a point of reference, that's what I always do. So I always cast my moves in the real world first. So I come to the process informed, and I come to the process with a strong point of view.
So how do you relate to the? How do you work with the actors? Are you a very hands-on person, or do you just cast correctly and let them do their work?
Now when I say it's a combination of the two, and I'm not ducking the question. And it's like, you know, so before we get, I do enormous amounts of homework, and so before we actually get the set, we know what the scene is about, we know where we're focused on the scene. But especially with this movie, I loved what I got about putting the guys in a real train at 60, 70 miles an hour, and there's accidents and mistakes, and then fighting the noise, or fighting the windows open, or the door fell off at the back. So they're fighting the elements, and what happens is you watch the performances grow and twist and change. It's not called improvisation, it's just about tone.
Right.
You know, and you watch the anger, the frustration, which happens in the real world. So I think for me, the goal in the movie was to keep everything as gritty and as real as possible, so therefore, I avoided CG because I feel that you really do, you can feel the weight, and it's hard to reproduce what I got on film CG.
Yeah.
You know, because I'm going to train it, I'm exaggerating, 70 miles an hour, 60 miles an hour, but I built it, and I said, you know, what I'm going to do is not be inhibited by the fact I'm on a train going at high speed through Pennsylvania in the fall, and it's freezing cold, it's raining. I said, I'm gonna shoot it like I'm in this room. I'll shoot it like I'm on stage. So I will ignore the fact we're doing 70. So I built a platform around the train. We did, we had a dolly grip pushing the master shot around. I had two other cameras hanging off the edge of long lens a bit. Wow. And then it's great because it doesn't inhibit the actors. And once they're rolling, it's like a piece of theater. You gotta let them roll. But we talked about it. We've got the role models. We've done all our homework. So it's a little bit of a combination of what you asked me.
So is your crew the same crew you've had pretty much on movie after movie? Or
changed up your DPs? My DPs vary, but like Ben Sasson on this, he was my clapper loader back in England 25 years ago.
Wow.
Danny Mindell was my clapper loader. You know, Huey Johnson, all the boys have grown up through the ranks with me, and my location manager has been with me 22 years, you know.
Wow.
So, and I use a lot of local guys. There was one in Pittsburgh who were great. But, you know, I tend to work with the same people. It's the same family. And it's a shorthand.
Yeah. Well, it sounds like you have to figure out different sets of tools for each of the movies. But it sounds like you're willing to push it.
Yeah. No, I love, and I hate repeating myself. My goal isn't, that's not just my goal every day, is to say, you know, how can I reevaluate? How can I look at this scene and these characters in a different way? And that confidence comes with my research, comes with me spending time pre the shoot, spending time pre Denzel even, and pre Chris, you know. And Chris's character changed because, you know, from the script I saw was almost blue collar working class. Right. And then I went and met the guys over there. And actually Denzel said, you know, I think it'll be a great chemistry between me and Chris, you know. And then one of the guys I met with was what I call a pretty boy who got the job because of nepotism. That was all fact. So we brought that and we put that in the script. And then Denzel was, and one of the guys we met, his daughter's worked at Hooters, you know. But all that stuff you can't, it's hard to conjure up.
Couldn't make that up.
You couldn't make it up. You know, and the real world, it always informs me, and it's fun, and it's more, it's really hard for you sitting at a computer trying to come up with that stuff on here.
Well, it's funny because Denzel brings the Denzel gravity to it, and then his daughter being at Hooters is such a surprise, and yet somehow you know that he's discussed it with them and they're okay there. It's a very interesting surprise in the movie.
No, and he loved it when I told him that. He said, yes! He said, that's a great little bit of humor, great piece of color. Yeah. That's exactly, he's always looking for that little thing because you don't expect that. You know?
And what is it with the two of you? I mean, you've made all the movies you've made since 2000, I guess. He's not been in one of them.
Five.
Domino was the only one he hasn't been in.
Five movies.
Is it just like, you know, okay, we've got another one, let's go.
No, it's not that. He's great at what he does, and I always think, I'm going to go somewhere else other than Denzel. And I always come around and say, and each movie, if you look at all the movies Denzel, he's always managed, or between us, we've always managed to find a different aspect of his personality that we've honed. And I'll never ask an actor to be someone over here. Always say with Chris, I want to hone this aspect of your personality in this character, and here's a point of reference. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And the same with Denzel. So you look at who he was in Crimson Tide. Mm-hmm. You look at him in Man on Fire. And you look at him in Unstoppable. It's all part of who Denzel is, but each time you hone that different aspect. Here's a little bit more of the everyman who felt he'd been beaten down by the system, and he got his moment in the sun.
Yeah,
you know, and
well, Man on Fire. It's really, that was like a career shifter. I mean, just the perception of Denzel in that movie really was, I think, shocking to people.
Right.
Because in some ways he's playing a bad guy. I mean, he's the hero, but he's also an anti-hero. Yeah. And he just dug right in.
And that again, you know, in our references, you know, we found this killer guy who had on tape called Iceman, and a real guy who trained bodyguards for the CIA. So those are our references, you know. So it's great when you can feed actors, and then you come to terms with who you are before you hit the set. And then when you hit the set, you let them do their thing. So, you know, I don't inhibit actors. Because as I say, even on the train, I shot my wide as a tracking shot. I got a long lens and a medium lens, and I let them roll, and then I get mistakes and things happen in them, and I capitalize off those mistakes, or we'll go to take or I'll do three takes in a row, and I'll try and lump together my dialogue in sometimes 10-minute blocks, so they can get a rhythm. They get going, then they go to take two, and they find another rhythm, so to take three, and one build off the next. And it gives you a sense of reality, you know. And it's like, I haven't for a long time. You know, when I first started, I was preoccupied with visuals. I came from, I was painting for 8 years, and I was preoccupied with the look and the light. Mm-hmm. And I was terrified of talking to actors. Well, I was terrified of talking to stars, not to actors. Well,
you terrified of Catherine Deneuve?
Eh? Oh, yeah, Catherine. And David Bowie, Catherine Deneuve was my first movie. I was like, oh, my God. And Bowie was, you know, was my God. And Catherine was the Ice Maiden. But she's, and then Susan Sarandon. I had a brilliant cast, and they were so... But I love what I do, and I create a good atmosphere on the set, not because I'm a suck up, because I get good product out of it. Mm-hmm. You know, people feel comfortable, relaxed, and it's good, so I get the best out of people.
But does it surprise you that The Hunger is still kind of a classic that people refer to?
Yeah, I couldn't get arrested in Hollywood after The Hunger. They said it was esoteric, it was artsy, and it took me 4 more years before. Mm-hmm. And they fired me from Man on Fire. I was originally going to do Man on Fire after The Hunger.
Wow.
And then they saw it and they went, oh my God, this guy.
It's hard to imagine any studio making Man on Fire back when back in the 80s, though.
Yeah, well,
kind of violence was not really...
No, I prepped it I was going to, and it was originally, the script was written in for Italy, when Italy was the kidnap capital of the world. Huh. And I met with Marlon Brando. So Brando, and then he said, you know what? I'm getting too big, I'm too fat, so and then I started talking to De Niro, and then the guy saw The Hunger, and they painted out my parking spot, and then Arnon Milchan called me when I was 25 years late, and he'd been channel surfing, so they made it then with a guy called Shiraki. Huh. It was a DP camera, a DP director, Frenchman, and
any good?
Nope. And then, so Arnold called me because I think he'd been channel surfing on a Saturday night, and he called me on a Sunday morning. He said, are you still interested in making The Real Man? And I said, yep, I love it. So, and then I think it was like a week later, I'm sitting in I'm getting acupuncture, I'm sitting in the office, and there's Denzel sitting. And I hadn't worked with him for 10 years. And I said, God, this must be a sort of connection. This is a sign. And he was great, wasn't he?
He was. He was fantastic. Well, did you, I mean, on that picture, for instance, there are a number of things in that movie, I think, in Man on Fire, that people are continuing to steal since then. One of the big ones being the way you did your subtitling.
Yeah.
Which you really made it part of the image and not just something you looked at the bottom of the screen. Was that something you were, okay, I'm going to try something different? Or when you build something like that, are you conscious that you're trying to do it differently? Or is it just the way it fits?
It's always about... You know, people think I look for hip ways of doing, whether it's hip ways of shooting stuff, whether it's Domino or Man on Fire, or you know, but it's not. I always looked at concept, and concept was, and I always looked, like I said on this one, one of the concept was on Unstoppable. Mm-hmm. Don't be inhibited by the fact you're moving at 70 miles an hour.
Right.
You know, shoot it like you're shooting in a controlled environment.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And on Man on Fire said, if Denzel thinks it, feels it, I'll show it, I'll communicate it with use of, and no rules, with use of camera, whether it's a hand crank, because the movie, you know, the movie was all about paranoia, betrayal, and so if he felt it, I'd show it. You know, so that was, that's what every movie I always find, I find a concept that I'll, that I'll, that's that one line on top of my storyboards every morning. If he thinks it, show it. That was Man on Fire, yeah.
Was there a moment in the in these many films that you did feel like you knew exactly what you were doing and that you were...
No, I never.
Still?
And that's what's good, though, because I always feel... And that's what's good about Denzel. I'm insecure about what I do, but in, but it's a healthy insecurity. And it's healthy, and I'm always reaching to... I get bored repeating myself, you know? So I'm always reaching for difference, but that's not just the thing that drives me. I get excited. You know, my, the greatest days... Oh, the greatest... The most rewarding days of my life when I'm doing the toughest scene, performance scene, not an action scene, and I watch these guys give it, and I watch them give it back and watch it perform, and it's so rewarding. Yeah, it's such a good feeling.
Well, for me, the best Tarantino film is still the one you shot.
Really? Yes.
Because he, you know, the dialogue is amazing.
Yeah.
But you were brought a visual level to it that, you know, he's not really capable of. I mean, he's a great director, but he's not that.
Right. But you know that it's when you get a script like that, everybody came to the set, nobody wanted to change a word. And the only thing that changed from the original script was the end, because obviously, well, not obviously, but Quentin had the Christian Slater character dying in the end.
Right.
And I shot it in continuity, and I didn't cop out by having them, you know, going off into the sunset. I fell in love with the characters, and I'm a romantic at heart, and I wanted him to live. Even though I shot Quentin's end, I shot, you know, Christian dying, Patricia sits on a freeway, puts a gun in the mouth and says, nah, fuck it.
Well, I think the scene between her and Gandolfini is still one of the most memorable in cinema of that decade. Certainly, sticks with everybody.
But I remember when Jim came in for that, he did exactly what he did in the movie. And it was that sort of, that little dance thing he did, turn around, spin around. That's what he did when he came and played it for me. I went, God damn.
So when you shoot a movie like that, do you know? I mean, do you know that the scene between the Hopper and
Walken
is going to be so iconic, or do you have a sense of that?
No,
or is that...
I don't know about being iconic. I knew on the page it was fantastic, and the two guys, the only thing that I brought to it, I shot it very simply.
Yeah.
I didn't do my moving camera and stuff, and because the scene stood up so well, the only thing that I think that I brought, which the guys brought in rehearsal, they were laughing, Chris and Dennis were laughing so hard when they were rehearsing the scene. I brought that sense of humor, which was the only thing that Quentin didn't have on the page.
Interesting.
And they were, and I shot it. I shot it fast. I mean, I think it's like four or five takes, one side, that side.
So, what got you from painting to shooting film?
My brother.
He just dragged you along?
No. What it was, I desperately wanted to be a painter. I was eight years in art school, and I helped Ridley. He's a little older than mine, and I helped him make his final diploma film at the Royal College, and I was in the film. So I was the driver, I was the grip, and I was the boy on the bicycle. And I thought, damn, I'm taking exactly what I do in painting, which is about making choices. It's about, here's your canvas, here's your movie. And as a painter, you're living in a vacuum. You're sitting in your apartment or your room or your studio, And I like that, the fact that I've got people around me. It's called responsibility and guilt and drive, and so I gravitated from painting to commercials to rock videos to television to film.
So does the thing with your brother just part of your life? And I mean, it's always what people talk about, is, you know, a Ridley kind of film, a Tony kind of film. The Scott brothers have a kind of this giant footprint in Hollywood or in the business.
Yeah,
does that mean anything to you, or are you just kind of part of your life?
No, it's part of my life. I love what I do, and it's you know, I love what I do. I wake up bolt upright every morning like that, and that's a good thing, not a bad thing, you know. And there's nothing more satisfying than a day when I feel I've achieved something and broken new ground, you know, in terms of what I've done in the past, and watching you know, and this film, this Unstoppable was mm-hmm. I'm like a general, I'm like Patton, and I think I'm good at it, but it's like, this was like choreographing Cirque du Soleil. Mm-hmm. And you got three helicopters, you got a train, you got, and it's exciting and it's dangerous. And and this was for me the most dangerous movie that I've done, not in terms of the stunts, but in terms of, you got a dolly grip pushing this thing around, and this train's doing 50 miles an hour, mm-hmm. and this telegraph pose whizzing by a foot away. So I worry every day that something could go wrong, and it's not the stunts I'm doing, it's just people not paying attention. Yeah.
Well, interestingly, the way you shot it, not using the CG, limits the shots on some level, and that, I think, keeps it more real. I mean, you have this train that's, 100 cars is supposed to be?
Yeah.
And, you know, you can't really encompass that in a shot.
No.
So, but you would if you were doing CG. You know, it comes up with some sort of way of doing it.
But it felt I wanted to be with the head of the beast all the time. I mean, mm-hmm. we were running on average 25 cars, because when I'm shooting the tight close-ups, and I'd select locations where the road would run alongside the track for 10 miles, mm-hmm. and then I can do multiple takes. I can do three takes with, you know, I'd lump it into maybe, you know, 7 10-minute takes, mm-hmm. and then I'd do three in a row, and then I'd have a camera car tracking alongside and the helicopter up above, and I'd choreograph the whole thing from sitting inside the mm-hmm. the actual train.
Do you give yourself a ton of options to edit at the end, or
don't. They have a storyboard every morning. I get up at trying to be a good guy here, but I get up on this one because we're in winter hours. I get up at 2:30 every morning. Oof. I storyboard till for two and a half hours. I take a shower, and then I got the set. And that's like, you know, directors do shot lists. I do storyboards. Other than if you're doing a major, like the derailment, I had to do ahead of time because we're budgeting. Yeah.
And do you watch dailies each day, or do you?
If I said yes, I'd be lying. Because my day starts at 2:30, and I get the event average around 10:30, 11 mm-hmm. when I'm shooting. So, but in the first week, you think, oh my God, I'm never gonna survive this movie. But you get 4 days in, and your body acclimatizes, you mm-hmm. know. And I function on average four and a half hours of sleep. But it's the adrenaline that keeps me going. And listen, I love what I do, and I'm terrified what I do. I'm terrified because I'm fear of failing creatively.
Well, they say that, I guess, the first thing that goes in a great director is his legs.
Really?
Because it's exhaustion.
I'm as strong as a bull. I'm an English stock.
Yeah. Well, you guys are. It's funny because we've been talking to a bunch of the English directors this year. You know, Stephen Frears and this whole group of people went to school together, now 60s and 70s, and are still working.
Yeah.
And it's pretty rare in the United States for American directors to work past. You know, Clint's like the only one. You're like getting to 70.
Yeah.
Slowly. Yeah. Do you ever expect to retire? Can you imagine?
No. Anytime I want to retire, I'm down. And it'll be a long time if you go down here. And I'm sound very mature here, but you know, when I finish a movie, I've been a rock climber. I climbed, you know, big walls my whole life. So, and I climbed most of the major walls in the Alps, the North Walls. Yeah. So I'll go do a multi-day ascent whenever I finish a movie, and I'll go on El Capitan in Yosemite. You ever been to Yosemite? Mm-hmm. You been
there? Yes, beautiful.
And I'll go and do El Cap.
I haven't climbed it though.
3 days, 2 nights on the wall. But it's like, it's that's not nearly as scary as the first day of filming a major movie. Mm-hmm. Stuck on old camp for 3 days and 2 nights. But I love it, because I think I'm a fear junkie. I'm a sort of fear junkie, fear in terms of failure and creatively. And I love rock climbing. I've done it my whole life. And I was in two minds whether I was going to be a guide or I was going to be a painter. And so I split the two, a good story. When we finished Man on Fire, which I'm very proud of, I went to a place called Chihuahua, and it's a big wall called El Gigante, which is a 4,000-foot wall, and we put up a first ascent there, and we titled it Hombre en Fuego, and it goes in the American Alpine Journal. Mm-hmm. But these kids went ahead of me, and these kids from Austin, Texas, and they spent 13 days on the wall putting up this, and I came in like the jefe,
Would you have to kind of be the macho guy to do what you do? I mean, isn't that part of the? Isn't there a swagger to being a director in pictures like that?
Yeah, there's a swagger. I mean, I don't think everybody's got an ego, but you know, I love what I do, and I think that my love of what I do is infectious to my crew and infectious to my cast, and therefore I think I get the best out of people. Yeah, and I think I'm a good general.
Has it changed a lot? Some say, you know, 10 years ago, as opposed to when you really started?
Yeah, I'm now, I've got confidence. I've got confidence with my actors, and that's what really motivates me, is characters motivate me. And as I say, the way I've just told you how I hone concept, and it always it always comes from the people, you know, from the characters in the movie, or comes from the characters that I research. So
what was it about Chris that drew you to him?
Chris, I started differently. I started thinking, after meeting the guys there, Chris should be blue collar, working class. And then Denzel said, you know, this kid, Chris Pine, I think there's a great marriage between us and him. There's a great chemistry. And then I flashed to this kid that I'd met in Pennsylvania, and he got the job because of, as in the script.
Right.
Did I tell you this? No, I didn't tell you something. I'm forgetting that.
No, we're good.
He got the job because of nepotism, right, because of the family, and he was a pretty boy. Yeah. So we totally reverse engineered the character to, you know, because I thought this is not just to accommodate Chris, I thought this is a great way to go, rather than two working class boys, Denzel, which is Kurtz really, and now it's Kurtz and Captain Kirk.
But you kind of get both out of Chris in a way. I mean, Chris does have that, still has a little bit of a blue collar edge, even though he's a pretty boy, and even though he's...
Oh yeah, no, he's, but he looks, he's educated and looks, you know, he goes to Oakwood, the same school as my boys do, or he did, and it wasn't the way I was thinking originally going, and that was through Denzel and through research. You know, Denzel's a director, and he's got a great eye. You know, casting is key into the casting and script. Yeah.
So was anybody else a huge challenge in terms of this? I mean, Rosario is kind of a huge surprise, but she works. It works beautifully.
Now she works because she's got a confidence and she's got a toughness, and we found a role model here in Long Beach,
right,
who is Hispanic, and so we honed her, and I gave her to Rosario. So, but she works, and she's the eyes and ears of the audience,
right?
Yeah, and she does it with such confidence. She's a bit like me. She's like she's a general, and she'd help me in there. And that was the only situation where. In the control room where I was shooting in a normal situation, which wasn't moving.
Right. Yeah,
everything else was moving, which is not a nightmare, it was a challenge and a scary challenge, because one day I had the train going from right to left, and it should be going left to right. So it cost me a day's shoot. Hey.
So do you have to be careful not to complicate it? I mean, one of the things I think that really works about the movie is that it is in many ways simple. It's not like there's not a villain who's trying to get the train to do this, and there are not all these complications. It's pretty straightforward, and yet you squeeze every bit of attention and action out of it.
No, it's a very simplistic story, because this is a runaway train going from point A to point B, and if it hits point B, it's going to be a nuclear holocaust, you know, to over-exaggerate. And at the same time, here's two guys who've got to resolve their difference, two guys like this, and they've got to resolve their differences and come to terms of what they're doing in order to win the day. Mm-hmm. And so I've got two things working in tandem.
Right.
I've got these two guys sitting in this confined space, you know, and it's the old guard, new guard. As I say, it's Kurtz and Kirk, and old guard, new guard resolving their differences, and then I've got this thing doing, you know, from 50 to 150 miles an hour. So I've got great tools to work with.
So what is your experience like in post? Do you?
I love it. No, I'm sorry, I want to say I love it. Every part of the process I love. You know, every part of the process I love, and I don't go in post to try and reinvent. Michael, are you good? He's hovering. No, he's good. He's good. But I don't go into post to reinvent the wheel. I go in post to, and I say a storyboard. So I have my background's painting. So I have a vision. And that vision I normally stick pretty close to. And those little, you know, crews never read shot lists. Most of them can't read. but you give them a storyboard at 5 o'clock in the morning or 6 o'clock in the morning, we stand around and it's freezing cold. And all you can see is their name tags and breath. And I've got these lights, and they've all been given the storyboards by then. They copy them. Mm-hmm. And Steve distributes all the guys. Then I have my toy train to say, today, we're doing frame 1 through 20. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and we're going to do this with a train and that.
So when you go into post on a picture like this, you pretty much are not surprised by what you end up with afterwards.
No, always.
Your first assembly probably looks a lot like
I hate it. The first assembly I ever made, I'd die. Yeah, and what I did, I went too fast. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it was jamming. And then, you know, I structured it so it could breathe and the characters could breathe. And if you remember the movie, it's like you're two-thirds way in the movie and the two boys are actually opening up their hearts in a way, which mm-hmm. about being corny, saying I've got a problem at home, or my wife passed away, and it's right in the middle of this. But that's great having that contrast and letting it breathe, you know. So, and when I'm shooting it, I let the camera, the movement slow down. So rather than a circle track getting faster and faster, I let it breathe and slow. I'll go to the static.
And the sound of this movie is actually kind of a character as well.
Yeah.
Because the sound of that big train moving is, it's like having sense around.
Yeah, well, and I call it the Beast. And the Beast is a third character. He's a strong third character in the movie. Mm-hmm. You know, it could have been an aircraft carrier. Mm-hmm. You know, it's 100,000 tons at 50 to 150 miles an hour. Mm-hmm. And I characterized it with my sound. You know, I used elephant and rhinos, and they say in conjunction with the wheels and the metal and the, so I got great tools to make, I think, you know, to make a commercial and a movie with integrity, because I've got great characters. I've got two of the best, two stars in Hollywood. And the studio kept saying, wow, damn, they're going to be sitting in this tiny confined space. But those guys are so good. Chris and Denzel are so good.
It works.
And so strong. And then you got Rosario, says so the eyes and ears. Mm-hmm. So, you know, when I'm in the cutting room, I can, you know, I'll go, I've got too much of the guys, or too much, or do this, I'll go to the train. I'll go to Rosario. Yeah.
So do you put the movie, when the movie's done like this, and now you're doing the press, do you just put it to bed? Is it emotionally, you know, over for you, or you does it stay with you?
I haven't finished yet. I'm still doing my, all the deliverables, say, like the television, the DVDs, so right. I'm still doing them. I'm color timing tomorrow on my on my video space, and then when I finish it though, I'm looking at the next one. I've been talking about the next one for the last 3 months.
So do you look back much, or do you not choose to do that?
I look forward, and this is a great adventure, a really tough adventure. You saw how hard it was. You can only imagine how tough it. But I respond to that. I love it. I'm like, fuck yeah, and I love this challenge and love this adventure. Yeah, and this was the I think one of the biggest adventures and toughest adventures I've ever encountered.